Hey guys, what's up? It's Philando here, and I'm doing another video where I'm going over some of my favorite albums from the past few months and just sharing my thoughts on them. So let's go. So first up, Maps is the second collaboration between the rapper Billy Woods and producer Kenny Cigar, and it is another slam dunk after their efforts on the album Hiding Places. Billy Woods has been on an incredible run recently, and Maps is one of his most accessible and relatable efforts, but still retains that incredibly dense lyricism and delivery we've come to love. With a solid set of guest features as well, this is easily Rap Album of the Year. Following that, Jesse Ware's fabulous fifth album, That Feels Good, is a classic disco revival done right. After her previous record, What's Your Pleasure, turned heads with its sensual dance pop sensibilities, this album is just going from strength to strength with a sound a little more bold, playful, and fun, without forgetting the beautiful melodies, catchy choruses, and soaring vocals that only Jesse Ware can deliver. Next up, Protomata have been pretty consistently one of the better post-punk bands over the past 10 years. On every album, they come through with quality songs and a high level of consistency. And their latest outing, Formal Growth in the Desert, may not be their catchiest, but possibly their most expansive and optimistic, as Joe Casey's wry humor pokes fun at the creaking decay of late capitalism. I think I'm taken for granted. Following that, on her beautiful and brutally honest debut album, Why Does the Earth Give Us People to Love, singer-songwriter Kara Jackson takes folk music and bends it to her will, exploring themes of emotional labor, agony, and adoration in equal measure. It's a slow burn, but Kara's captivating voice and commitment to painful vulnerability makes this record one of the most bittersweet listens of the year so far. Next up, In Search of a Better Tomorrow is a fascinating collaboration between the Polish jazz ensemble EABS and the Pakistani instrumental quartet Jawi. For two groups with distinctly different sounds and styles, it's surprisingly cohesive. And with both bands being signed to Astigmatic Records, I hope for more collaborations met through the Get Your Jazz Together program in the future. Following that, McKinley Dixon further solidifies himself as one of the best hip-hop revelations of the 2020s so far. Much like his previous album, at just under 30 minutes, Beloved Paradise Jazz is shot full of fantastic, incredibly lively beats, and Dixon's heavyweight flows and expressive styles make songs with a renewed urgency that demands repeated listens. Next up, Petrodragonic Apocalypse is the 25th album from the prolific Aussie rock group King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard, and it sees them dipping their toes back into thrash metal. The riffs are fast, impactful, and heavy, just like 2019's fantastic Infest the Rat's Nest, with similar themes of environmental destruction, but this time around the songs are a little more complex, progressive, and ambitious. Metalcore is having a bit of a revival right now, and Jesus Peace is one of the bands leading the pack with their latest album, So Unknown. It sounds brutally heavy, full of breakdowns, chaotic hardcore riffs, and songs just so immediate. The ambient and sludge metal influences from their earlier works are mostly gone for an album that sounds just as pummeling as their live shows feel. Following that, How Are We Feeling Today is the latest release from the EDM artist Kaizo Slumber, and this album does everything modern digital hardcore excels at right. It's incredibly loud, abrasive, and manic, and I especially like how this project can switch things up between sweet and silly, but the energy is just constant. For fans of artists like Machine Gal and Death Grips, this is a must listen. Next up, the noise pop group Feeble Little Horse come into their own on their short yet richly textured second album, Girl with Fish, which is full of fuzzy melodic hooks and lackadaisical left turns. All the tracks are self-recorded and produced, and are such an oddball burst of imagination and whimsy, and with a runtime of less than 30 minutes, it makes for a real short and sweet listen. Following Following that, No Highs is the latest album from the ambient producer Tim Hecker, and it's another great example of how much he pushes the genre, using swelling synths, creaking strings, uneasy organs, and creeping growls of distortion. No Highs is built to alienate and unnerve, and the cold, harsh wave of the sonic textures throughout are some of his most compelling since the album Virgins. Following that, Queens of the Stone Age have been on a rollercoaster as of late, and their latest album, Times New Roman, is a reflection of those ups and downs, but fortunately the songwriting and performances here are a real return to form. As Josh Homme confronts his recent turmoil of these hard rock grooves, it's the heaviest and bluesiest the band have sounded in years. Next up, the Ghanaian American singer Amare really comes through with an innovative and unconventional yet confident sexy sophomore album. Fountain Baby pulls from various shades of Afrobeat and R&B to create a memorable and sensual record that flows, saunters, and boasts its way to one of the best pop albums of the year so far. Following that, it's taken me some time to warm to King Krule's signature brand of slowcore art rock, but Space Heavy might be Archie Marshall's most potent album yet. It's enough a dive into a deep molasses of psychedelic gloom and a woozy atmosphere that no other artist has really been able to replicate, and while writing with a newfound lens of fatherhood, it's all the more mesmerizing. Next up, the art rock quintet HMLTD's latest album, The Worm, is a fantastical progressive rock opera featuring a string orchestra and a gospel choir about medieval England being devoured by a parasitic giant worm. On premise alone, it's annoying theater kid music, but the songwriting is considered and compelling, and the performances are anthemic, and the concept lends itself to a lot of fun here. Next up, Glorious Game is the debut full-length collaboration from El Miquel's Affair and Black Fort, who had a great return to form last year with the collab album Cheat Codes featuring Modest Mouse. It's a tough act to follow, but Black Fort's delivery and lyricism is as sharp and tactful as ever, and with instrumentals grounded in funk and soul's roots, it's a really solid hip-hop album. Next up, with the explosion of post-punk in Britain these last few years, it was difficult for Squid to stand out, but their latest album, O Monolith, really showcases the band's ability to really juxtapose delicate melodies and introspective moments with bursts of raw energy. The instrumentation is dense, and Ollie Judge's vocal performances can be as wild as ever, and it's a worthy follow-up overall. Next up, the London fusion artist Alpha Mist is back with swinging jazz fusion and laid-back UK hip-hop on their latest album, Variables. Mist proudly wears his influences on his sleeves here, and if you're looking for something that scratches that flying lotus itch, this might be it, as it's a real sweet spot of accessible and experimental jazz rap. Following that, with their classic late 60s songwriting and beautiful harmonies, the New York duo The Lemon Twigs have never mined the past more effectively and effortlessly than on this fourth album, Everything Harmony. There's a genuine timelessness to the tracks here, and some of the bleaker lyricism scattered throughout makes for a refreshing twist on the vintage sound they manifest so well here. And finally, but here we are, is the latest release from the legendary rock band Foo Fighters, and the first without drummer, the late Taylor Hawkins, who passed away last year. For a band going through their motions on the last couple of albums, this is an incredibly heartfelt and intense listen, and such a painful exploration of loss makes for some of the band's most powerful songs in years.